great intro, Al. Welcome to the guest room. Thank you, everybody who watched the first episode. I'm so glad to say all I've gotten is support from friends and family and just everybody who watched the show. So just a big thank you for everybody who watched that show. And, so my first guest is Josh Harris. He's just a very funny comedian. He recently just kicked off his Kickstarter, but he got the touchdown, so he got the money, and he's doing a comedy/music album. I have the same song that he's done stuck on my head, Sabretooth. I don't know if there's a clip, but it's a great song. It'll be a very good album, and I'm glad to say he'll be up. So right after this break, we'll have Josh Harris, the great Josh Harris, up. So.
Are you ready to get glazed? It's time to get glazed with Dan Glazer and friends at Jerry Farber's Side Door Hour, featuring Comics on Parole Open Mouth every Wednesday night at 9:30 at Jerry Farber's Side Door at 3652 Roswell Road, Atlanta, Georgia. $5 admission, which includes free wings and sandwiches. So join us for a mouthful of laughter at Jerry Farber's Side Door at 3652 Roswell Road, Atlanta, Georgia. Give him a call, 770-738-3000. That's 770-738-3000. Or visit him on the web at www.jerryfarberssidedoor.com.
I want to give a little shout out to Jerry Farber's Side Door. We have an open mic, open mouth at Jerry Farber's Side Door every Wednesday at 9:30 p.m. It's a $5 door fee, but you get all the chicken wings you want to eat, all the sandwiches, and some stage time. So come out to Jerry Farber's Side Door. Also, let's give a shout out to all the other great open mics like Laughing Skull, The Basement, Improv, Bonkers, and there's many more. So have a good time on an open mic and go out and enjoy yourself.
Hey, we're back. Welcome back to the guest room. So I'm going to do this clip of Josh Harris of his Kickstart. So we'll get to see that, and then we'll do the interview.
Awesome. I'd love to be the father of all of your kids, but they're 30 years older than me. Oh, hi. Didn't see you there. I'm Josh Harris, stand-up comedian, writer, and actor for Sketchworks Comedy Theater. You may have seen me on Bill Bellamy's Who's Got Jokes, or in one of my hilarious music videos like Sabretooth. See, I bring joy to the world through stand-up comedy, sketch comedy, and my favorite form of creative expression, comedy music. And that's why I'm here. See, the goal of this Kickstarter campaign is to raise enough money to fund my first full-length musical comedy album.
You are what you eat.
See, these aren't your typical comedy songs that don't make you bust a move. No, this music's as catchy as it is funny. And did I mention completely clean? And with your support, I'll be able to get the studio time, musicians, and producer to help me create this hilarious album. Hey, Yukon! You've heard a lot of great things about my comedy, but don't take my word for it. Listen to how my hilarious music's changed the life of this fanatic listener.
Before I listened to Josh's comedy music, I was white and a woman.
You're welcome, Vanessa.
My favorite book is Eat, Pray, Love.
You may be wondering, Josh, why do you need my money when you're lounging in a lavish pad like this? Well, that's simple. Because it's not mine.
Who the hell are you?
Oh, hi. I'm comedian Josh Harris.
What the heck are you doing in my house?
I was actually just promoting my Kickstarter campaign. See, I was about to let the people know I have incredible incentives to give away, like autographed DVDs, comedy albums, tickets to my shows, even a professional massage from Melissa over here.
I think I'll take that massage. and you're gonna wear this. And you're gonna let me call you Dorothy.
I don't think Melissa's gonna be comfortable with that.
I wasn't talking to her. I was talking to you.
Bro, that ain't happening.
Well, I guess I'm gonna have to mess you up then for breaking and entering.
Please help. Support this campaign so I can create hilarious, clean comedy music with amazing production value that brings joy to the masses. This has been my dream for a long time, so please give, and together we'll make this record truly special and create more hilarious music videos that can be featured at Sketchworks. You're going to be so grateful that you supported this project, because I promise when you listen to this album, you're going to laugh, you're going to dance, you're going to learn to love yourself all over again.
Time for my gloops, Dorothy.
Alright, so go tell all your friends about that. I like that on YouTube. You know, share that with all your friends. That was a great job of
Thank you.
Dressing up like Dorothy.
Hey man, had some practice.
Yeah. So, what made you decide to create the Kickstart?
I always love doing music, and I've incorporated music with my album quite a bit, and music with my comedy quite a bit. You know, I was really passionate about it, and I guess I just feel like it was sort of a God-given inspiration. I just really felt passionate about that in my heart, you know, and I was doing this kind of, this, you know, working with some friends and other creative people, doing this book called The Artist's Way and stuff, where it sort of inspires you to follow, you know, different creative visions and paths in your life, and I just really felt like a strong tug to give this a shot, and so, you know, all the pieces sort of fell together, and we, you know, we put it out there, and the response was good. You know, you never know what's going to happen, but right. It was just sort of seemed, when we were doing it, it seemed very natural, and you know, it was really cool just to see how the road sort of opened up naturally. It was awesome.
Did you have a comedy or musical talent at an early age, or did you just kind of grow into it?
I started off doing music, and then I was, you know, I should, it's a little of both. I've been to 11 different schools in my life, not because I was networking, but I was always getting in trouble as the class clown most of the time, and so I always knew that I was into comedy, but early on, like, I did get into music, and I was, you know, started drumming pretty intensely in high school, and, you know, took that, rode that for quite a while, and studied some piano in college, and, you know, so that was sort of like the first creative outlet I guess I was like formally, you know, into. And then, you know, your dad, who was super awesome, got me on stage for the first time, and you know, sort of went the comedy route more intensely, and now I'm sort of circling back in the musical direction a little bit. So I really love, I really like composing and creating stuff in the studio and just watching it all come together, you know.
Yeah, it's great. And that brings me to Sabretooth. I don't know why I'm so stuck on that song, but I'm sure there's a really funny story behind what inspired you to write that.
Yeah, it's interesting. I was doing a show in the I don't know if I'm super proud of this, but I was doing a stand-up show one time, and there was like this really, there was this drunk heckler in the audience, and she was a little, you know, definitely drunk, and quite a bit older than me, and she was, I don't know if I said a joke about cougars, and she was like, woo, I'll be a cougar, and I was like, well, ma'am, I think you'd be more like a saber tooth, I don't know why I wouldn't have said that now, but that was maybe like 5 years ago or something, 6 years ago. And, you know, got a decent response, but she was really cool with it, and we sort of played off each other for a little bit. And, I sort of had it as a little bit of a comedy routine, but, you know, one day I was just sitting at the piano, and somehow it turned into a song, you know, and I thought, oh, this could be probably a better song than stand-up routine, and it worked out pretty well.
Was there a first song, a comedy/music song that you did?
I did do one, yeah. It was called White Minivan. It was about the first car that my mom got me. This is true. The first car my mom got me was like a white minivan, like a 1993 Plymouth Voyager, which is a very creepy car. And I guess she just didn't want me to, you know, ever date women or something. So she got me this thing, and I drove it for a while, you know, and it was so creepy. And it was, you know, it was like you could see through the windows. All the cloth seats were there. It was just like every episode of, like, you know, it just fit every, like, suspect description or car automotive description you've seen, so, of every suspect. And I did a comedy song about that, and it actually got quite good reviews and response and stuff, so I always knew there was something there. I think one thing I noticed was, like, earlier on, my musicianship wasn't necessarily at where, like, I saw, like, the vision of things, so it's like I had these visions and ideas in my head, and I was a decent piano player, and not a good singer at all, and right even today I'm like okay, but you know, I needed some years to kind of incubate and get better at piano and get my voice a little bit better. So now I think the really cool thing about the album is I'm actually at a point where I can deliver musically like what I'm envisioning, and I'm really proud of the musicianship and the collaborations that I have involved with this. So I think I have all, you know, been blessed with the resources and the people and the tools to really create something that I think is, you know, industry standard in terms of, like, musicianship and songs and you know, collaborations and stuff like that.
Yeah, that's really cool. And I think that most comedians, they kind of live on more like a day-to-day basis, which I've noticed being around comedians a lot of my life. But where do you see yourself in the comedy or any business in 10 years?
10 years, interesting. You know, I guess it's so up in the air. I'll just, you know, I'll have to go where God takes me. But I guess, you know, for me, it's, I came into this album and I was just thinking like, oh, I'm going to do more. I don't know. I guess I thought I was going to, you know, develop this big musical comedy show, and maybe that's going to happen. You know, I do definitely think I need to chase and pursue this album and see just as far as I can take it. But to be honest, I've been writing so much, and the music, and my favorite part about writing music is when I have like great guest singers on my albums. I like working with them much better than I like working with myself, because they sound so good. When I hear them, I'm like, wow, this is what it would sound like if someone like that was singing the whole song and not just this guy over here. So, I mean, I don't know. To be honest, I would really, really like to get more into songwriting and music production, and I'd like to do a follow-up project, which would be potentially serious music or, you know, more serious subjects, faith-based subjects, whatever, and have like really great singers on the album and not sing much of it myself, and just see like how poppy and good I can have it sound and see what happens with that.
So like a songwriter, and you'd want
to
do
Yeah, I would still like to have my name behind it, you know what I mean? Kind of like how Calvin Harris does or something like that, where he writes an album, but he just has like really, really great singers on every track for the most part. But yeah, I would like to see what would happen if I did that as well. I mean, don't get me wrong, I want to see what happens with this, and we're going to shoot some music videos and put it out there, and you know, fingers crossed we'll get a great response. But you know, that's something I'm very interested in as well, seeing what would happen if I wrote serious stuff in collaboration with like really established singers.
So besides being present, you would be a songwriter, which is
I think that would be cool. I would like to see what happened. You know, I mean, it's fun to do. I like composing, and I wanna also get much better at piano and you know, recording and on all the technical side of things as well, and just figuring out more of the science behind it.
And I know this is, I've been around comedians a lot, and I know there's the positives and there's the negatives. Have you experienced the negative aspects of comedy?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, sure, I think, you know, there are plenty of negatives and adversities, but at the same time, depending on how it happens, they can be spun into positives, you know, like, I mean, I've been booed off stage before. I've had one guy say he was going to beat me up if I didn't get off stage, which I did get off stage. You know, but at the same time, I think I could say that was tough, but I look back and I'm like, well, that was really character building. You know, I mean, bit by bit, you care. I don't know if you care a lot less about what people think about you, but you learn to you learn how to kind of have a little bit of armor and let it roll off you a little bit easier.
They hate us because they ain't us.
There you go, baby. I need that bumper sticker.
Oh, yeah.
You need to make it.
All right, well, this is Josh Harris. You can watch that video when the album comes out, the comedy album. Listen to that. Listen to him, Jerry Farber's, whenever you can. He's very funny. Trust me on this. I've been around the club, so I've watched him probably 6 times, and it never gets old. So watch him, and Dan Glazer will be on right after this. So
watch this guy. He's an emerging comic as well. He's hilarious. I love his stuff when he gets up there.
Yeah, man, but I'll see
you. Bring to the parole desk Mr. Jerry Farber.
Thank you. I'm fine, Dan. You're lucky. If that's all you've been called is Daily Dan and Dan Dan, you're pretty lucky.
That's right. I've been called worse. Jerry, just want to tell you, I bumped into a guy that saw your show recently, and he's followed you throughout the years. And he says, every time I see Jerry Farber perform, he makes me feel 20 years younger. I said, well, that's nice. Why do you say that? He goes, because he says the jokes, same jokes from 20 years ago.
That's great, Dan.
I just made that up.
I know.
Leave the joke to the professionals.
I usually steal a good line, but that one's yours. You're married to it.
That's right.
It's never too late or too soon to wish everybody a happy.
Hello.
Hey, so this is Dan Glazer. Dan Glazer has been a major player at my dad's club, Jerry Farber Side Door. The commercial you saw, or the clip that you just saw, was him doing his open mic and him doing his show, Comics on Parole. It's a great show. I've watched it many times. So, yeah. So,
thank you for having me, Josh.
Thank you.
I just want to tell the other Josh, I will never boo you again. I apologize.
So, how was it like meeting Barry Farber? I know you couldn't tell that from the clip, but how?
Well, I'll explain that clip before we show it, because it didn't go in the part with your uncle on it.
Right.
First of all, it was a great honor meeting your dad. Your dad, I used to go see your dad 30 years ago, 25, and your dad was always a celebrity in his mind to me. And, I mean, in my mind to him. Anyway, he really was always a celebrity to me. Mm-hmm. And one day after taking a comedy class the first year I took it, this is about almost 3 years ago, 4 years ago, I stopped into his club, and he was there by himself. And we just started talking. He said, come on to the club, as long as you don't say any four-letter words, you can do the open mic anytime you like. And it worked into us tying the Comics on Parole show in to his open mic and call it Comics on Parole Open Mouth Open Mic.
Wow. So,
but if it wasn't for him, I'm not sure I would even be still doing it.
Right.
He's a very wise man and a very funny man.
Wise is something that's new, but
it is.
What made you want to do a TV show in this American Hearts?
It wasn't my choice. It was part of my parole agreement. No, I'm just kidding. What happened 4 years ago, I took a comedy class, and then I took part in a competition to do 5 minutes at Louis Anderson's club in Vegas. So kind of almost by default, I won, because I had won 3 times, and there weren't enough people that showed up for the contest. So they said, whoever wins the next one gets to go. So I won the next one and got to go. And I was real comfortable with going to it until a friend of mine who lives in Vegas said, Dan, you better be good. There'll be 1,000 people in that audience. And that made me a nervous wreck. I actually woke up the day before. I said, I'm not going to do that. And I went there. There were 60, 70 people in the club. And he was the nicest guy in the world. So when I got back, your dad actually was supposed to go on Dennis Aloia's show to do an interview, but he wasn't feeling well. So he called me and said, Dan, could you go on my place and just talk about Louis Anderson? And so I went there, and before we went, Dennis and I were sitting in Arby's, and he said, Dan, do you have any good ideas for a show? And I said, yeah, like an open mic show for all the comics going round and round in circles here in Atlanta. So that's where it came from.
Right. And so about comedy and the open mic, I know there can be some good open mics, and I know there can be some bad open mics.
Right.
So what has been your best open mic, and what has been your worst open mic?
You know, every single one of them has a good moment and a bad moment.
Right.
But that's what open mics are about.
Right.
People trying their new jokes, and if they don't work, they don't use them when they go to a place to really perform.
Mm-hmm.
So that's really what an open, so there are really no good or bad. The bad ones, no one shows up, but luckily we always have a packed
right.
House of Comics. It's House of Comics is what it is. Mm-hmm. We do get some civilians now and then, but comics, we're like the open, after open mic, after all the open mics. Everyone goes to their main open mics, and then they come to ours afterward because they want to perform their stuff. So we try to get everyone on stage, which is really stressful because sometimes we'll have 30 comics come in.
Right.
But that's what it's all about. It's not really about having a good or bad show. It's letting these comics try something to see if it works.
Right. And so you've tried stuff there, too.
Most of my stuff doesn't work. But the show isn't about me. It's about the comics.
Right. So what made you do that open mic?
Oh, well, it was your dad's idea. They had someone else running, and he didn't want to do anyone, and he said, let's tie the show in with the open mic. And what's fun about it, I get up there and say a few jokes, but mostly what I like to do is after the comics are up there, I like to joke about them after they're up there, about something to say. That's what makes it fun for me. I like to joke about the comics.
Yeah.
But someone the other day said, Dan, you're so mean. But I'll tell you, if I have a roast, I want you to perform it at my roast. But that it's all in fun. It's all in love for my friends and everything.
Yeah, there's some sensitive people out there. But...
And did you have another question? Because I wanted to also say something about your uncle.
Oh, about Barry Farber. I was just saying, I don't think you ever said about how good it was meeting her or what he was like.
Barry?
Barry.
Well, I'd like to show a clip of it, but this man is a legend in talk radio. He really was the pioneer in talk radio. And he politically... Jerry is on the left and he's a little on the right, but they love each other like brothers. Oh, no, they are brothers. But the thing is, this guy was on To Tell the Truth, and he's really more a libertarian. But they like that your dad and your brother like to debate each other, and they love each other. And that's what makes it great. And he came on the show with your dad, and we talked to him. If we could take it back to a clip.
He's bringing to the parole desk Mr. Jerry Farber.
Thank you.
How are you, Jerry?
I'm fine, Dan. You're lucky. If that's all you've been called is Daily Dan and Dan, you're pretty lucky.
That's right. I've been called worse. Jerry, just want to tell you, I bumped into a guy that saw your show recently, and he's followed you throughout the years. And he says, every time I see Jerry Farber perform, he makes me feel 20 years younger. And I said, well, that's nice. Why do you say that? He goes, because he says the jokes, same jokes from 20 years ago.
That's great.
I just made that up.
I know.
Leave the joke to the professionals.
I usually steal a good line, but that one's yours. You're married to it.
That's right.
It's never too late or too soon to wish everybody a happy holiday.
That's
and
right.
Good health.
Yeah.
More than anything, as I've aged so much, that good health is the best.
Yeah.
And I just had surgery, and I just had a charisma transplant, as you know.
I've heard they took out
my charisma, and they put, and it wasn't painful. I had it at Duke University.
Yeah.
And so now I have brand new charisma. I feel terrific.
Very good.
Man, I'm just amazed. You know what the blessing is?
Yes, no.
That you've maintained this show.
I know, it's amazing.
And it's incredible. No, it's great. You're doing terrific with it.
Well, what we're doing, we want to pay honor and homage. We want to honor someone who's very accomplished and happens to be related to Jerry Farber. His name's Barry Farber. Tell us a little. Barry Farber is Jerry's older brother. He was just inducted to the Radio Hall of Fame.
Right.
And we're going to call him in a few minutes, but tell us a little about your brother.
Well, I met him when I was a baby, you know. I had the same mother and father, grew up in Greensboro, North Carolina.
Yeah.
And he was already 8 years older. So, you know, when I was 5, he was 13, already had his crowd. But I always loved him, but he was a high school and collegiate wrestler.
Right.
And though he speaks 30 languages, to me, as this high school wrestler, they called him Spider.
Uh-huh.
Because he was tall, skinny, but my earliest memories of my brother, which you'll talk, were using those things to develop here.
Right.
And I don't think he ever lost a match in high school. So he was my always the bigger brother who was a wrestler. Then, of course, he had this career in radio, which I'm very proud of.
He's extremely accomplished. He knows 21 different languages. Look him up on Wikipedia, Barry Farber. It's very impressive. And he's been on radio for years. He's had a television show. And this is what I was impressed with. I'm going to show you a couple clips of him. Oh, no, first let's take it to this first clip. This is where Barry Farber was on To Tell the Truth. Some of you younger crowd may not remember To Tell the Truth, but us older people do. Put on this clip of To Tell the Truth.
This was in the 50s.
One New Mexico policeman described in detail a brilliant white egg-shaped object which roared away as he approached. A state police captain says he found the ground still smoldering several hours later. While many of the hundreds of sightings each year can be explained as the result of natural phenomena, Others, so far, seem to be without a logical explanation. Signed, J. Allen Hynek. Three gentlemen all claim to be Dr. J. Allen Hynek, astronomer and Air Force consultant on UFOs.
So that was your uncle on the right, tall guy.
Right.
So
okay.
Very prominent man.
Right. And, so it was fun talking to him, obviously.
Oh, yeah. Well, it was an honor.
It was an honor. Yeah.
Talking to him. So the next day I called him. He couldn't get the show worked, so he asked me to call him to show him how to get the show, so I did. Then I said, I want to ask you one question, Barry. Is there any hope for this world? He said, that is a really good question. I want you to call me back in an hour and ask me when I'm on the air. And it had gone over an hour and I couldn't do it. I had to call him and said, listen, I've got to get to work, so I couldn't do it. But that was an honor for him to ask me to do that.
Oh, yeah.
He's a legend. And the funny thing you didn't see in this clip is I was on the phone with your dad. And while I'm on your phone, your Uncle Barry called in. And then Jerry called me back and said, you're not going to believe it, Bill O'Reilly just called to ask Barry to a party. And so before the show started, Barry, your dad came on the show, and we called Barry. He said, Dan, don't ask him about any celebrities. He doesn't like celebrities. So we're doing the interview. It was going great. At the end, I said, hey, Barry, Barry, I just wanted to ask you. Jerry called up. I was talking to Jerry, and while I was talking to Bill O'Reilly, called up to ask you to a party, and how was it? That's all. Your dad got so upset with me because he didn't want to ask me about celebrities, but it's just something that popped in my mind.
Right.
Anyway, but it turned out to be a good show.
It could have been. Yeah, it was pretty natural.
Yeah, it was very natural. It didn't even look like your dad was mad, but I could feel the vibes.
Right, yeah, the vibes are real. So
the vibes were devastating.
Yeah, and I know, I don't know how many people know this, but you are a hero to the Farber family for what you did at that fight. There was a thing, but you saved the show. You really did. I mean, I can't tell you enough what you did, and you did that.
You talk about your dad?
Yeah.
Well, thank God he didn't get hurt.
Mm-hmm.
And your dad's tough.
He's really tough.
And, he's like a real relative to me now. And when I saw are we allowed to say what happened?
I don't think we have enough time.
We don't have enough time. But anyway, someone came up, pushed him, so we jumped in, protected Jerry, and we said, call the police. The guy ran off, and the day he was saved, Jerry's okay.
Yeah.
I think that's it.
Yeah.
Listen, Josh, I want to thank you for coming on the show. Right. It was wonderful having you.
Thanks. I'll do it. And then, all right, so thank you for all watching. Go see Comics Parole on?
On every other Tuesday, first and third Tuesday of the month.
All right, and on American Hearts Radio, you can help Josh with the album, like I said. Just support everybody. Thank you for watching, and peace out to the guest room.